Hello and welcome to Ullapool. Well, sadly, not Ullapool, but my house. I'm going to guess that, like you and me and everybody else, we've been looking forward to over the last year, focusing throughout this pandemic, this terrible pandemic year, on the second weekend of May, and that pivotal time for all of us, the Ullapool Book Festival. And sadly, both last year and this year, that hasn't happened, and that's why I'm not there. I have to say, as this welcome address from the honorary president of the Ullapool Book Festival, I have to say my honorary presidency has must be the most troubled and troublesome in the entire UBF history. However, I think that even given the fact that we can't be together this year in Ullapool, doesn't mean to say that we're not going to have a fantastic celebration of books and reading and a great Ullapool Book Festival. I mean, in a sense, writers and readers weren't really supposed to be together. I mean, it's all about it. What's so fascinating that we can read people from many, many miles away and many, many centuries apart and still feel a connection. Right now, I'm working on a text in Satire of the Three Estates, written 470 years ago, and yet I feel this connection with David Lindsay. But in Ullapool, we do love being together. We do love walking around the streets of Ullapool and going down to the Cayley Place and of course the Scones and chatting about who we've listened to and what we've heard. And in a sense, I think that can keep on going. And in one sense, better even than usual. This is going to be another great Ullapool Book Festival. Joan and the team have gone out their way to make it as Ullapool as possible. And it's as rich and as deep and as varied as it always is. There's Gaelic poetry, there's music, there's poetry from Ayrshire, there's crime from today, the here and now, and from the Victorian era. There's travel writing, there's political writing, there's history. All those conversations that we have every year in Ullapool about who we are, where we've been and where we're going. And this year, although we don't have that one special weekend in the second weekend of May, we are going to be together every Wednesday night, right through spring, right through summer into August. So in one sense, that's really, really special. And I'm kind of so looking forward to all that. And this is quite a special spring and summer. Hopefully at the end of which the world will look in a more recognisable shape and we can look forward to 2022.
Welcome to another event in the Ullapool Book Festival 2021, which is a more socially distanced book festival than we'd all have wanted, but another thought-provoking mix just the same. My name is Ruth Wishart, and I have the pleasure of being in conversation with Fiona Mackenzie, the archivist of the National Trust's Canna House, the longtime residence of the late Margaret Faye Shaw and her husband, John Lorne Campbell. Margaret Faye Shaw was an utterly remarkable woman, as is evidenced by a film produced by Fiona and featuring excerpts from her life and from the lives of those Hebrideans with whom she spent so many years and from her own quite remarkable photographic archive. So first of all, we'll watch this touching cinematic tribute to Margaret, and then Fiona and I will have a blather about the making of the film and about its exceptional subject. So let's see Solas.
Hey! My name is Magda Sagarzazu. I am from the Basque Country in Spain, and I am going to tell you about how I came to know John and Margaret Feixoo Campbell and the Isle of Canna. John had known my father since they were in their teens, so I have known them all my life. My mother died when I was 9, and the Campbells then came to Spain. When I was 11, it was decided that myself and my sister should come and stay on Canna. My idea of an island as a child was a piece of land with palm trees, but I arrived to a beautiful, real island. As a girl growing up, life with the Campbells on Canna was an education itself. It was a house of many languages. We would speak French with Marguerite at the table and Spanish with John, until we learned English. That's why I called her Marguerite. And they would tell us why they came to Canna. This is their story. Margaret Feixoo and her husband John Lorne Campbell moved to Canna in 1938 after living on the island of Barra for 4 years. With them came their love of life, animals, music, art, knowledge and stories. Every corner of Canna House holds a story, as does every tiny object. Many of these will stay in the memories of us who knew them well, but many others will never be heard again. Marguerite had a gift with people. She was a brilliant entertainer and teller of stories, which she filled with color and wit. She had an eye for photography and the moving picture, leaving us with a myriad of images linked to as many stories, songs, and lore. Images of work, life, celebration, rest, and reflection. There were always several cameras in Canna House. In case the light turned special, the cats and dogs looked particularly attractive, birds and butterflies visited, or simply to document the arrival and departure of visitors. Photography was always present in Margaret's life. In fact, it was through photography that she met John at the Loch Boisdell Hotel in South Uist. He needed images for the Sea League magazine, which he published to defend the rights of the local fishermen in the Hebrides. When we were alone, we would often look at her photographs and films of the islands in the 1930s. She talked about the people, the songs and stories they shared, or the moments the images were taken. People in her photographs looked relaxed and comfortable because Marguerite arrived in a place and stayed. I remember her saying, "I was living with the most amazing people. I loved them dearly. They became my close lifelong friends and I loved every minute of it. I was just living." At the time, I was not aware that what I was doing would have such significance and would be appreciated and enjoyed by so many wonderful people around the world, and by the people in the photographs themselves, and their children, and their children's children. I remember Marguerite as this vital creature, full of life and always laughing. It was the happiest time of our lives. Canna was the center of our world. But of course, it all started long before then.
This is a BBC Home Service. Portrait of an Island. Margaret Fay Shaw describes the way of life of her island home between the Inner and the Outer Hebrides.
The life of a music student in New York was mine in the 1920s. I lived in a brownstone house on Madison Avenue in the center of Manhattan. Every room of that house harbored the would-be artist. Pianist, violinist, cellist, singer, dancer, painter, and dramatic student. We musicians filled the building with the din from morning till night. The silent ones were the dancers, stubbornly practicing their high kicks, splits, and tap. The ones who suffered most were the dramatic students who had to learn their lines, oblivious of noise. I practiced the piano many hours a day, so intent on my own efforts that I never heard the noise of my colleagues. It was a wonderful life for the young, full of dreams of great achievement. Or going to concerts in Carnegie Hall, to me the finest concert hall anywhere. We would stand if we couldn't get a seat in the top gallery, which we call Peanut Heaven. It's the best place to hear orchestral music. The three great symphony orchestras gave their winter series of concerts there. The Boston, the Philadelphia, and New York's own Philharmonic. One winter, I had a part-time job as an usher for the Philharmonic Society so that I could hear as many of their concerts as possible. Toscanini was then conducting, and I had charge of the second-tier boxes. I would open the doors for the occupants with a key, and I would try to leave the little windows of these doors open so that I could hear the full volume and pray the inmates wouldn't notice the draft. My greatest joy were the piano recitals, and it was a time of giants. Paderewski, Rachmaninoff, Badowski, Gabrilowitsch, Schnabel, Hoffman. It thrills me to name them now. But there was so much more, and it was all ours to hear and remember. Besides my piano, I had one love which was then a relaxation. Folk songs. Whether Irish, Greek, French, or Russian, any volumes I could find in the music public library, I'd bring home to study and enjoy. With my little knowledge of Scotland, I knew of Gaelic songs, and the Kennedy Fraser collection was among them. But there was also another, to me the most valuable of all, Miss Frances Tolmie's collection of songs from Skye, Egg, and Uist, unaccompanied and with their original words. This book was an inspiration. It came at a time when I had to make a hard decision. I couldn't continue my lessons as a pianist. It could never be my profession. In the autumn of 1929, I sailed for South Uist. My ambition was to learn Gaelic and note down unpublished songs. My music training, I hoped, would prove its worth there. I took with me a Gaelic dictionary, a grammar, Martin Martin's Tour of the Hebrides, a little Irish harp, a pitch pipe, and plenty of music paper. I chose South Uist after I had cycled and walked the length of the Outer Islands. It attracted me like a magnet, and it still does after all these years. I have some Scots blood, but it doesn't predominate. I am a true mongrel of the Western countries. Most of my people have been in the United States for nearly 200 years, some much longer. I have never felt a kinship with Gaeldom, only love, real love. I was wonderfully fortunate in being in a house which was, and is this day, the very home of all that is best in Gaelic life and tradition. From the very moment of my arrival, I began to learn, first to do without. Plumbing was the hardest, and I was a poor hand at trimming an oil lamp. There were no green vegetables and fruit, which I thought so essential. My clothes were the wrong sort, and my shoes always leaked. To go anywhere meant walking, and usually a long way. To reach Loch Boisdale, we crossed the sea lock in a sailboat, and often over a rough sea. I grew to love this boat and the many sails I had in her. I never knew such wind. It whitened the window panes with salt from the Atlantic 4 miles away. Blew the burning peats out of the fireplace onto the floor. First, the noise of the gales made me as nervous as a cat. But I got used to them. I had never seen men and women do such hard physical work. And I certainly had never lived with people who had so little of material things. I am speaking of the days before wireless, electricity, Swedish houses with all the modern comforts, and plenty of cars. It wasn't long before my heart began to deteriorate in the damp weather. I would waken at night to the sound of springs snapping. But for myself, I never felt better, nor was I ever so happy. When my new friends understood that I wanted to learn their language and to save the songs, they took endless trouble to help me. I must have been a bore and a trial, but they were patient. Later, I was told by people from the South how difficult it must be for me, a stranger without Highland blood, to be accepted, and how the U.S. people wouldn't welcome an outsider taking down their songs, that it would take a long time. I was glad I hadn't been told this before I arrived. If they felt this way, they were much too polite to show it. I knew only kindness from the first day, and that glen is a lasting home for me.
So Merlennan, he Merlennan, she Merlennan, fair
Merlennan. I wasn't capable of taking down much that I heard because of the difficulty with the language. Three members of that little community died while I was there, and they took with them a priceless store of songs and tales. The songs were more beautiful than I had imagined. Everyone sang. It was their accompaniment to life. It was well I hadn't a piano nor means of hearing any music but the songs. They're often complicated and modal, different scales to our classical music. They certainly are foreign to the piano. My ears have become accustomed to them, and I was better to keep my head clear for concentrating on them alone. Here is a lullaby, Tala Poinich Org, a lullaby for young Kenneth, sung by Miss Peggy McCrae, which I recorded at her own fireside. Kenneth was born in 1569. He was the son of Colin Mackenzie of Kintail. And this lullaby is said to have been composed by his nurse, who was a McCrae. Miss McCrae's people originally came from Kintail. This is the translation of the words. Mackenzie, do not be downcast. Your mother never handled a cow better, or wore a white plaid, but red silk and green satin. Mackenzie has gained honor amongst the lords. He used to buy wine of London town, and his servants rode on saddled horses. Great Mackenzie of Bran, son of the hero who would not endure contempt, you would buy wine for your horses and shoe their feet with horseshoes of gold. More than a year later, I returned to New York for a short stay. I took with me the first little collection of tunes, also a cinematograph film of agricultural life on South U.S. croft that I had made. It was at the height of the American Depression, a terrible and hopeless time for my countrymen. I showed this film of men and women working on the land, carrying seaweed from the shore in creels on their backs, plowing with a cast crown, a kind of foot plow, reaping the oats with a sickle. My audience was most interested. One anxious businessman asked, "Tell me, these people, are they as happy as they look, smiling and laughing? Is it real?" "Yes," I replied, "it is real. They are truly happy." The tunes I showed to a well-known composer. He was amazed. "Why, these are beautiful. What themes for symphonies?" Themes they are, of the symphony of the life of these splendid people. Thank you. continued to live on South Uist for some years until I married one who shares the same interests.
Barra was a prosperous island compared to Uist, which was poor, and the Uist folk were called the Rogalech, meaning the shaggy or hairy ones. John and Margaret moved into a corrugated iron house where Compton Mackenzie had been living. This little house had been a shop, and their landlord was the great storyteller, the Cody. Margaret was given $500 by her Uncle George, and she was determined to have a Steinway grand piano. So the grand piano was sent out by steamer to Castle Bay and then brought by lorry to the little tin house. John wanted to be near his friend Compton Mackenzie. Compton was a born actor, and everywhere he stood was a stage. He held open house. He didn't own Barra, but he did buy a small piece of property called Suyahan, which means sitting down place. Although it took many years for Margaret and Compton to become friends, he became a frequent house guest of the Campbells during their years on Canna, writing most of the well-known story Whiskey Galore there. But life on Barra was a continuing fascination for Margaret and her camera. Among the Barra friends who were telling John Gaelic stories was Miss Annie Johnston, a native of Barra whose knowledge of songs and stories was endless, and who was a perennial spring of Gaelic folklore. Nova Scotia beckoned in 1937, an opportunity to record John's Gaelic-speaking friends there. They travelled from Christmas Island to Glace Bay, filling their cylinders with rare songs and stories in towns with names so familiar to them. But the voices were not always Gaelic voices.
On the island of Canna, and on a clear day I can see Uist from the hill behind my house.
It's small in comparison with its neighbors, with their dark towering mountains. When you're sailing towards it, you'll see how very green it is. There are high cliffs to the north and south, but the rich grass grows to the very edges of them. There is nothing of the desolate brown moorland that you see in this part of the world. There is even a thick little wood near the shore. We all farm the land. Sheep and cattle are the living of the island. The Highland cattle are my special interest. I think they're the best tempered and most intelligent of all the cattle. There's no finer sight than to see the shaggy bull with his widespread horns, grazing with his wives, and the furry little calves with their ears like teddy bears. There is always fishing, and we like to encourage our guests to do that. For the sake of the house, which includes the cat. We catch lobsters at the low spring tide in the rocky bay on the south shore. There's an art in catching them by hand with a heavy wire and a net. You must know their hold, and if you move any of the rocks at the entrance, you must put them back in place, for lobsters like to use the same dwelling and don't want anything disturbed. My garden has a high wall round it, protected from the gale. With shelter from the wind, this soft, warm climate can produce every kind of vegetable, and many flowers and sprouts which can't survive the cold of the mainland. There's not a day through the year that I can't pick flowers, for we rarely have any frost. Our winter days are lively when Peggy Andra comes to stay for her long visit. Peggy is from Hewitt, a tiny bird of a woman of no age, with a store of wisdom and a hand that can do anything, from making candles to the best of scones, black puddings, and sheepshead broth. She's a beautiful spinner, and the wheel in the hall, which looks to be only a museum piece, is brought to the fireside, and Peggy spends her days making yarn for socks and pullovers. She sings all the time she spins, and I hear such tunes that I rush in to ask her, what one's this, what's that? But now she's well past the one I fancy, and there's no going back. If you can't give a line of the words, she can never find it. What treasures have gone into the yarn and the socks she knits? The wheel is the secret of bringing to her memory songs without number, stored in her mind from childhood. The exquisite little song,
never heard at concert or cave.
Stone offices have been dug up in the mounds left by early man. The graves of the Vikings that lie on the lovely curve of green grass by the bay. The ancient stone crosses and the circles of beehive huts the first Christian missionaries made. For St. Columba was here and is said to have driven all the reptiles into the sea, so there's no poisonous thing to be found. At the foot of the garden is the bay, and at low tide I watch the waders, oyster catchers and sandpipers, red shanks and curlew. They're feeding, and they call and whistle with the gulls. The eider ducks are nearly as tame as my own ducks, for in this island we forbid the shooting of any birds. In the night I listen to the shearwaters who come in after dark from the sea, making their eerie cries. Though I'm particularly fond of cats, I haven't found that they drive the birds away. The black tom sleeps in the long grass below the cherry trees, oblivious of the scolding of blackbirds and thrushes. Indeed, I wish they would take my cats a little more seriously and leave us some cherries. For with all the fruit we grow, the birds always get the largest portion. I'm often asked if this isn't a lonely life. It's not. People who work with animals are never lonely. I remember visitors arriving on shore from the yacht one lovely summer day. A neighbor was busy making a beehive. "You're far from the world here," said the yachtsman. "I'm in the center of my world," was the reply.
Two or three weeks ago, the South Jewish people came over here to give me a birthday party. I mean, what greater reward could I have than that? To have these wonderful people who brought me the piping and everything, and who I know loved me. And by George, it's wonderful to be loved, let me tell you. When you have real affection and you know that they love you, it's the biggest reward in life. You can't ask for anything better. No money, no nothing can ever buy that. I've been wonderfully blessed. In the meantime, I need a light.
Come on.
Fiona, so tell me a bit about how you put the film together, because it's such a rich mixture of old photographic images and footage mixed with quite a lot of fabulous contemporary views. I mean, it's how did that all come to pass?
Well, it was a joy to do the whole project, but it was also a huge challenge because of the wealth of material that Margaret Fayshaw left us. I had been given a sum of money from the NTS USA Foundation donors, and it was for using the media archives. So I decided that one of the best ways of telling the story of Margaret and John and Canna House was to use Margaret's own voice and her archive material, her films and her photographs, excerpts from her diaries and her letters, etc. But then my next problem was how to choose, you know, what to go with it. But because over the years I have developed a good knowledge of the films, I was able in my mind to interpret Margaret's words and see what she was seeing when she wrote the words of her scripts.
But then you had, of course, to get a filmmaker on board to.
Yes, that's right.
Yeah.
I worked with a filmmaker from Aberdeenshire, Pete Wolsey, and he came to Canna for 2 weeks, and we sat side by side, and I gave him all the material, and he had a whole array of editing, a suite of editing software and hardware, and I said, right, I want that piece of film in there and I want that piece of audio in there. So he had the technical know-how of how to join it all together artistically. I had the knowledge of the collection. So
I'm guessing though, Fiona, that might not have been entirely all sweetness and light, because there's one thing I know about filmmakers, that they've got their very own fixed ideas about how things should be.
Oh, yes, that was very much the case. I mean, we got on like a house on fire, but he had his own set ways of doing things, and he would say, no, that's not the way we do it. And I would say, yes, maybe, but I want you to do it. You know, I want you to do this, Pete, and please just trust me. So he did trust me, and he has become equally entranced by all of the collections as well. He knew nothing about Margaret Fayshaw before he came to work on Solas.
Maybe that was no bad thing, you know, because maybe he would bring to it not only a lack of knowledge, but complete objectivity.
Absolutely. He came with no preconceptions about it at all. He'd worked on Gaelic material before for BBC Alapa, but he wasn't a Gaelic speaker himself. But he, you know, he was able to bring to it a freshness and an objectivity, which maybe I might have found difficult to stand back from. So I think we made a really good partnership in the end.
Well, you certainly produced a really beautiful film. I mean, it's gorgeous. The whole thing is gorgeous. The whole concept's gorgeous. Now, let's go back though to Margaret and because her own story, the history of Margaret Fayshaw is quite remarkable. She had cycled through the Hebrides some years before she actually migrated here, hadn't she?
Yes, that's right. She eventually came to live in South Uist in 1929, but some years before that, in the mid-20s, she decided to cycle up through England from Southampton when she got off the boat from America, and cycled up through England and right and up to Scotland, and then she went to Skye, and then she went on to Harris and Lewis. So it was quite a journey for her.
It was. But the thing that I know that she had a love of folk song from all over the world, and that was one of the things that attracted her to that this neck of the woods in the first place. But why was it that Geildrum had such a particular and powerful attraction for her?
Well, when she was in school, she went to school in Helensburgh for a year in 1920 because she was such a difficult teenager that her relatives thought they would bung her off to Scotland and see if the old country could sort her out. So when she was at school in Helensburgh, she had heard Marjorie Kennedy Fraser singing Gaelic songs at a recital, and she'd been immediately entranced by them, by the flow of the melodies, although she recognised that Marjorie Kennedy Fraser was presenting them in a Victorian art form. Yeah. But she knew when she was hearing it, that's not the real thing. That's not the pristine thing. That was the word she used.
Maybe we should wind the tape back a wee bit, because she was, of course, a consummate musician in her own right. I mean, she was a music student. She was she could have become, or she thought she might have become, a professional pianist. So, I mean, she was a woman with a fabulous ear for music anyway. But even so, what intrigues me about her journey to South Uist is that she winds up, she was in a brownstone in Manhattan. She was at a conservatoire. She was in that very buzzy place that we know New York to be. And then she chaps on the door of a wee cottage with nae plumbing and says to the McRae sisters, can I have a room, please? And they've only got one room because they're keeping in a cupboard.
Absolutely. But she knew that that was where she was going to find this pristine version of the song. She could tell that the song that she was searching for came from the land, basically. And she'd heard the people speaking and recognised the rhythm of the language. And she knew that to really get into that song, she had to immerse herself in that culture and really live the life of those people who were singing the song.
She's got a Gaelic dictionary with her and a grammar book and somebody's guide to the islands, and that's about it.
That's it. She had Martin Martin's Voyage to the Hebrides. She had a little Irish harp, which she was given when she was at college in Manhattan. But she soon found out she couldn't use it in South Uist because the salt air made the strings snap. And some manuscript paper. That's what she took. She had no physical ways of recording songs or stories. She didn't have any recording machine, so she had to physically write the songs down. And she was the first person to do that. Because of her musical training, she was able to use her ears and work out the intricate modes that there are in Gaelic song and the time signatures or the lack of them, because nobody had ever really done that before.
It's still quite remarkable. I mean, I keep coming back to this thought about the culture clash, if you like.
Yes.
So I can't help wondering what the McRae's made of her. I mean, I know she wanted to get to know the McRae's and all the other islanders because she obviously fell in love with their way of life. But, I mean, what would they make of her?
Well, they just seemed to accept her. I think they recognised the honesty in her. They'd had people come along before and afterwards who would use them for what their culture could give them. But nobody took the time to stay with them and actually learn. And they recognised in Margaret that that's what she wanted to do. She really wanted to open her heart and absorb it. And they grew to love her. And they just accepted her. They respected her. She respected them. And she didn't try to use them. She mucked in. She milked the goats, you know, and she collected the eggs and she got reaping and she got seaweed in the creel. She just got her hands dirty and got in there for several years, which nobody ever did.
She made two observations about life there, which I thought were very telling. One was, as she said, when she went on a visit back to New York, that she'd never met people who worked as hard. Yeah. But she also said she never met people who were happier. And she seemed to embrace both the lifestyle, as you've just pointed out, but also she also seemed to get a kind of personal contentment out of it all.
Absolutely. I think that there was where she found what she had been missing in America. She'd had a happy early childhood, but then she was orphaned at quite a young age, and she'd never really settled and never really fitted in when she was a teenager. And that was really why she came to Scotland in the first place, was to try and find some kind of equilibrium in her life. And Scotland and the Hebrides gave her what she needed, and she just could be herself. She didn't come under the pressure of her sisters. She always thought her sisters, she had four of them, they were quite meddling as far as she was concerned, and her aunts who had brought her up. So she was free of all that, and she was free of the whole society thing which she had to live in amongst it when she was at home in Pittsburgh. So she could just be herself and find herself, which is an amazing, amazing thing for, at that time. You think a young American woman, and I mean, she would have been an object of curiosity for everybody at the time.
She makes one or two wry observations, but I mean, in a very kind of low-key way, she said, you know, it was difficult to get used to things in the cottage at first, especially the plumbing. I mean, so I was saying a minute ago, not so much not all mod cons, no cons at all.
No cons at all. There was no plumbing at all. The water was in the burn at the back of the croft, and there would have been a wee privy outside somewhere. But no, there was absolutely no plumbing. No, I mean, there was nothing on the floor. It was a dirt floor. She did, however, like to take herself off to the Loch Boysdale Hotel on a Sunday afternoon, and she would have a bath and a hot dinner there. So she liked that.
Okay, so that's our life in South Houston. I mean, and she obviously loved that, and they, as you say, they came to love her, and she managed, you know, to fit in a way you wouldn't have expected a complete stranger, a complete foreigner, to fit into quite a close-knit, I would imagine, quite a close-knit community, but she did all that. But then she met somebody who had a similar love of not just of Gaelic songs and music, but of folklore generally, and who also had an American mother, and that, of course, was John Ron Campbell.
Yes, that's right. They met in the Loch Boysdale Hotel at a meeting that was engineered by Finlay Mackenzie, who was the proprietor of the hotel at the time. Because John was writing his Book of Barra then with Compton Mackenzie, and he needed photographs for it. And he'd heard about this strange young American woman who was going around taking photographs and writing down songs. So he asked Finlay to engineer a meeting. So Margaret was playing the piano for a pipe major in the back smoking room at the hotel. And John came along and they got chatting, and he asked her for photos, and she wouldn't give him the photos to start with. But eventually he just kept on at her, and eventually she gave him the photos. But till her dying day, she said that he never did pay her for them. But they recognised in each other a kind of similar, you know, a desire and a need and a want to give something back to these people who loved them. And by giving them their skills, I mean, John had the mechanical know-how. So they made a very good team, because he had the machines now and he could do that. He could record them physically while she wrote them down, and you know, and had the musical side.
But seeing you brought up machines, Fiona, it struck me when, I mean, her photography is exquisite, but at the same time, the material, the stuff she was using, the equipment she was using was pretty well Stone Age. I mean, it must have weighed a ton apart from anything else. And I remember her saying at one point in her book that she had to get people to sit for 6 minutes to let to take the photograph. Can you imagine asking anybody to, you know, it's the antithesis of the smartphone photograph.
Absolutely. I mean, her main camera at the time was a Graflex, and it's like a bigger version of a box brownie. It's quite big. And I think she wrote that it weighed, I think it was 13 pounds it weighed. So it was quite a beast to lug around. And then she was one of the first people to use a movie camera as well. We've got all these machines in Canna House still. But, I mean, she writes of using the Graflex when she was taking photos on Mingilly, on the cliffs of Mingilly. If you've ever seen the photos of Mingilly, you know how big those cliffs are and sheer they are. But she used to get one of the shepherds to kneel down on all fours, and she would rest her graphics on his back to take the photos for 6 minutes or however long it was.
She sounds pretty fearless.
She was intrepid. I mean, she was a real pioneer. She would try anything, you know, and she had no training in photography at all, which is amazing when you look at some of her photos.
Yep.
If you look at the book, Eilean, to go with the film, Solas, you can see that she knew how to compose naturally. She was very good at composition. And you can see that there are pictures of families, you know, and she has them graded in size and height naturally. She had a way of shouting to a lady with a hoe, getting her to turn round. And you get this beautiful snapshot of her that's not posed, completely natural. But she just, I think, because people felt relaxed with her.
Well, but they did seem to, in a very unusual way, really trust her, because, you know, to let people as close to you, literally in the case of the photographs, but to let people into your lives and as close to you as that in that community means that she must have had a very special empathy.
Absolutely. I mean, when she took her book, her Folk Songs and Folklore of South Uist, back to South Uist in 1955 to show them to Peggy and Mary, I mean, they were in tears looking at these photographs of the people that they had grown up with, because this was the first time really they had seen photographs of their people. And they took in every detail. She writes about that, saying that when Peggy and Mary were looking at these photographs, they could see things that she hadn't noticed because they were so unused to looking at photographs. I mean, yeah. We just take it for granted. It's just part of our lives. You know, but to see a photo in print in the 30s, 40s and 50s was not a common thing. So it was quite an unusual thing. But she could reach into their psyches and their personalities and just pull out who they were. And they recognised that and they loved her. They genuinely loved her.
I think, too, Fiona, it's not just a question of her to reflect their lifestyles back at them, which was obviously a treasure trove for them as well as for her. But it struck me looking at the book, which is a beautiful thing of beauty in itself. In fact, it's a hefty old book, but it's an absolutely beautiful book. And it struck me looking at that she was obviously acutely conscious of the need to leave a legacy of that lifestyle, not only to lose the songs and the music and all of that, but not to lose the lifestyle and the habits and the customs and the culture.
Yeah, I think when she first started working, she was just doing it from the love of it. And she writes that. But later on, once she was with John, they realized what they were doing was documenting that lifestyle that was rapidly disappearing. And they felt privileged, I think, to be able to do something to help preserve that lifestyle for future generations. They realized that actually what we're doing is really important. But it was all self-funded. They didn't get grants from anywhere to do their work. That was a bone of contention with John from time to time as well, because other people would get money from various places and universities, but John didn't. But then he didn't want to be attached to universities because then he would have to do what they told him to. But yes, I think in their mid-years, they realised that they had the opportunity to do something very special, which they did.
Now, I've just remembered before we get to Canna, when they were in Barra, initially they were living in a little corrugated iron house that had belonged to Comte Mackenzie, I think.
Yes.
And Margaret had got, I don't know whether it was a bequest or a grant, but she'd got money from a relation, $500 or something, which would be a huge amount of money then. And when you think of all the things she didn't have in her life, what she does, as you would, she goes and buys a piano.
Of course.
Or rather, the piano, the Steinway, no less, is shoehorned into this wee corrugated iron.
Yeah. Oh. It was a wedding present of $500 from her uncle in New York. And she decided she was having her Steinway. So there was no question about it. So she got her Steinway, came from Edinburgh, came up on the train first, I think, and then it came on a fishing boat over to Barra. And Margaret took black and white film of it going up the steps into this rickety tin-roofed hut that they had. And it took pride of place in their drawing room. And we still have the piano now. In Canna House, beautiful thing.
I wouldn't have any choice but to take Pride of Place because I wouldn't be looking for anything else.
Oh, I know. It's absolutely beautiful piano, and she would play every night in Canna House right up until she was 101 when she was completely blind, but she just played by ear and she still had a beautiful touch. She played even for her 100th birthday party. She played.
Well, we'll come on to that birthday party in a minute or two, but just talk about getting Canna House, because that's where you're sitting now, and that of course was left to the National Trust by the couple. But I mean, that's a splendid house compared with the corrugated hut we've been talking about.
Oh yeah, well John wanted to establish, he wanted to have a small estate where he could continue to establish a traditional Gaelic crofting community with a croft at the heart of it, with the church and the school at the heart of it. And he had looked at various places, the Shant Islands and various other places, but Compton Mackenzie actually phoned him up one day when he was on Barra and said, Canna's for sale. So they decided that they would buy Canna between them. And they very nearly did, except Compton pulled out at the very last minute and left John with the challenge to find the extra dosh to buy Canna, which they did in 1938. So he moved here with a view of making the island an even better farming, crofting community and living the life of a working laird. If you like. I mean, he did work. He wasn't an absentee landlord. You know, this was their home, and that's where they lived until they both died.
I suspect, you know, Fiona, that had Compton Mackenzie come through with, as you so eloquently put it, the dosh, if Compton Mackenzie had come through with that, that would have made him a sort of, you know, a co-laird, and I don't think that would have been down all that well with Margaret somehow.
No, I think it took a while before they were able to become friends. I think in a way Compton almost resented Margaret, because obviously, you know, she was married to John, and Compton resented the time that Margaret spent with John. He wanted John's time to himself. So I'm not sure how that would have worked. Compton and Faith at the time were going to live in Canna House, and John and Margaret were going to live in Tyard, the house up the hill, which is now the guest house. But also, I'm not quite sure how Compton might have fitted into Canna life. I think with it being such a much smaller community than even Barra was, I think it might have been.
I can't visualise them mucking out the byre.
No, John certainly did, but I don't know. I don't know enough about Compton to know whether he would, but I doubt it very much.
You could guess. Do you think in the middle of all this, you know, we've talked about her American roots and, of course, about John's American backdrop as well. Do you think at any point Margaret got homesick?
I don't know that she got homesick. She did go home a few times before she moved to Canna. She went home for various family weddings and things, but she was always itching to get back to Scotland. And then once they were on Canna, there were frequent visits from all her sisters. They came over here quite a lot. And I think they could see Margaret in Canna House in a way that they hadn't been able to see her in the Croft House in South Uist. It kind of more fitted their idea of what was proper for a Pittsburgh lady, you know. So there were several family reunions here. So she kept going back to Pittsburgh right up until after John had died in 1996. She went back to Pittsburgh with Magda Sagarzazu, who was a previous archivist, and her companion. They went back then to Pittsburgh, even in the late 90s.
Magda's story itself is fascinating, because she, of course, came from, I think, the Basque country, and yes, was sent over as a teenager, or younger than that even. And I remember in one of the book that you've flagged up, she said that when she was a girl brought up in Spain, she thought of an island as somewhere, you know, sort of palm fringed and warm. And that wasn't used. And it's certainly Canna.
Yeah, Magda came here first in 1961 when she was 11 years old. Her father, Saturnino, and John had become good friends in the 1930s in the Basque Country. Magda's father worked for John Lorne Campbell's mother, who had an estate just outside Biarritz. So they'd become good friends, and that was how that relationship grew up. So Magda and her sister, they spent most of their teenage years on Canna, and Magda continued that relationship and eventually came to work here and be companion to Margaret. So her contribution to the collections is phenomenal, and she's very sadly missed now on Canna.
Sure. Now, we talked briefly a minute ago about the 100th birthday party. And, you know, I dare say the health police wouldn't be very happy to see her celebrating her 100th birthday, asking for a light for her fag. But she had some wonderful visitors for it, didn't she?
She did, yes. A fishing boat full of Uistich people from Uist came over in the fishing boat to come to her birthday party. And to her, they were the VIPs. Not the big wigs from Edinburgh or Inverness or wherever, or the BBC film crew or whoever. It was the people coming in the fishing boat from South Uist with a pail of Uist tatties. And she said that was the best present that she could have had. So she had a wonderful party with bagpipes and everything. And she played the piano.
And there's footage of them in your film of them dancing, yeah. having a reel on the show.
Yes, that's right. Yeah. Well, they had a great day, and it's still very much in the memory of the Uist people. And we still have that close link, which is wonderful. Don't often find that these days, but if there's a big event to do with Canna House and the archives, then the people from South Uist will still come over. They did a couple of years ago to a symposium that I ran, and it was wonderful, wonderful just to have them here. It's an amazing bond, really. It's incredible.
Well, one last thing I want to ask you, Fiona, because you've got a very enviable job as the chatelaine of an archivist in Canna House, and you're living amongst all these wonderful artefacts and diaries and mementos and all of that memorabilia. Is there anything in that house that's a special favourite of yours?
Well, it's difficult to put a finger on one special thing. If I can say two, then there's a wonderful portrait, a charcoal portrait of Peggy McCree, done by a Swedish artist called Roland Svensson, who was a very close friend of John and Margaret. And he did a wonderful portrait of Roland, a wonderful portrait of Peggy when he was in Canna House one year. And to me, it's so simple, and it just encompasses that cheeky smile that Peggy had, and it's just wonderful. And apart from that, then Margaret's diaries are just amazing. You know, if I'm feeling a bit sad, you know, just over the last year, I've been immersing myself in her diaries and starting to transcribe them all. And she just had such a wonderful way of telling stories and making you laugh. Even as a teenager, she was writing in an amusing, lively, witty fashion, and with little cartoons in the margin and everything. So her diaries to me are a real picture of a young American woman in Scotland growing
up. You make her sound like a kind of Hebridean Dorothy Parker.
She absolutely is. It's a film score in itself, just waiting to be put together, you know, and I've already got it in my head who would play Margaret.
Well, listen, Fiona Mackenzie, it's been grand talking to you, and what a lovely lot of tales. Now, if we can just get a wee shot of this, because it's an absolutely spectacularly beautiful book, full of memorabilia, full of the photographs, and full of just that wonderful life that Margaret V. Shaw had, and the memories that she's left everybody with. So many thanks, Fiona.
More than time.
On the edge of the west, beneath the wilds of the Fannies, the Jeeri, Bengola, Ullapu, Cooridin sanctuary.
Where the skies rise further, where the heather scores the west, Summer Isles, Hebrides.
These houses painted white, a metropolis whose streets you can count on your fingers, and the pier, its tongue stuck out, looking salt from the air.
Here are friendly, welcoming people. Fish suppers, a ferry black and white, flapping flag, silver sparkle, coconut broom.
Here, it's the scale of what blows through you as the wind burls the islands, sieving winter's thoughts from our heads.
And all along Market Street, the bloom of cherry blossom, making a Japan of Ullapu.